Oh, hi, Mark Pearson, Executive and Artistic Director of the College Light Opera Company, coming to you from the West Falmouth Library, open now for curbside pickup. Welcome to Second Stage, a week in review of work being done by our talented orchestra members. Second Stage is made possible by a generous gift from Caroline and Jim Lloyd. Let's see what the Highfield Philharmonic was up to this week.
Hi there! My name is Zachman Lopid, and I'm the Associate Conductor for the 2020 Digital Clock season. This week, for the Orchestra Masterclass, our special guest was Broadway Music Director, Music Supervisor, Conductor, and most importantly, Clock alum, Andy Einhorn. Andy Einhorn most recently music directed and conducted the Carousel Revival on Broadway in 2018, and has worked on shows such as Cinderella, Holiday Inn, Light in the Piazza, Hello Dolly, and many more. And this week on Second Stage, we will feature even more of our supremely talented orchestra members.
I'm happy to share a bit of my background so you understand how I came to be where I am now, stuck in a quarantine department. But I grew up in Texas. I started performing as a kid, like on stage. And at the same time, I always played piano. And I actually started school. I went to Rice University in Houston. I started school actually as a voice major. And in the middle of my first semester of freshman year, I found that I was playing piano for all of my friends who were voice majors. And I sort of didn't have that desire anymore to get up and sing in public. So I had always had this interest in music directing and conducting, and then so I switched over to piano purely because at that point, to me, you know, I was in a classical music program, but I just figured, okay, let me take advantage of having 4 years in a great program, learn as much as I can, orchestration, arranging, you know, counterpoint, all of the necessary luxuries of being in a great music school, but also just develop more piano technique. There was no undergraduate conducting major, and as much as I tried begging anybody who would do it for me, they wouldn't. I had moved to New York in January of 2005 and ended up working as Adam Gettle's assistant on Light in the Piazza at Lincoln Center, which was opening at the time, like doing finale work that way. Then went to Goodspeed and then spent 3 years on the road. And I was on the road with various shows. So I did Lion King, I did Light in the Piazza, and then I did that crazy Sweeney Todd where people played instruments. And the first show I conducted on Broadway was Sondheim on Sondheim, which was a review with Barbara Cook and Vanessa Williams and Norm Lewis and some other really great people. And I was piano conducting and then sort of, you know, sort of like one thing led to another. While I was on the road early on, I had a weird experience that a professor from Rice called me. He was the contractor down in Houston. So my advice to all of you is make friends with whoever's your local contractor in your city, because you never know what interesting experiences can come out of it. So this contractor calls me while I was on the road and he said, Houston Grand Opera is doing this, these two one acts with this Broadway singer. Her name's Audra McDonald. Would you be interested in coaching her? And I was like, hold on, let me think about it. Yes, tell me where to be. So like, that's how I met Audra, and that's sort of how that came about. What's really interesting is we're in this weird revolution where a lot of opera companies are starting to do more golden age music theater, which is a great thing for people like you all that are skilled musicians that understand both classical and the musical theater rep. Because I think the more facile you are as instrumentalists, and who here are my reed doublers? Do I have any? Okay, you will work your entire lives, you know? And like, for those of you who might play woodwinds, like, if you have the opportunity to learn you know, another instrument, do it, because I think that always will stand you in good stead. But, you know, the number one piece of advice is make yourself as flexible as you can as musicians so that you are enormously valuable. Your skill set is this. Like, everybody has sort of a sandbox of what your skill set is, and that's really great. And you need to hone that, and you need to refine that, and you need to understand what your skill set is and what your limits are. And you can also learn how to sort of push those boundaries and continue to expand those, but also understand what you're really right for. Like, if you know that you are not an expert at Latin music, do not go out for jobs that are looking specifically for people who, you know, are excellent at playing that kind of music. But understand that you also do have right as people to push yourself and to go to that level and be able to get there. Why don't, please, somebody take the rein and ask a question.
Yes, hi. My question for you, Andy, is what do you see Broadway looking like post-pandemic, like the reopening, and how do you see this playing out for all the musicians?
I mean, my biggest concern, to be perfectly honest, is I actually don't understand. I don't think Broadway will actually be able to come back until there's a vaccine, because I think proximity is a real issue. But if we're talking about what was going on before the pandemic, I unfortunately think the trend continues to drive from drive to smaller orchestras and sort of, you know, every show on click track. And I have fought my entire career against the click track, because I don't think that that is actually making music. I think that when you when you're forcing people to play to a click, there's a time and a place for it. If you're in a movie session, that's the way that world goes. If you're recording something for TV often, that's the way the world goes. But theater is live, and we should be allowed to make music. You know, thankfully, we do have places like Encores, which has a great live orchestra up on stage for their shows every year. And I think, you know what, I'm really hoping for in terms of entertainment is that there's a desire to go back to shows that are pure old-fashioned fun, whatever that means. And I'm hoping that in doing so, that means that, you know, we're allowed to have some of the splashier old-fashioned musicals that seem appropriate for this day and age. You know, the issue is producers say that orchestras are expensive. And I would like to challenge that notion, because I think that's BS, because everybody can find the scale that musicians are paid on the AFFM website. It's all there. So you can do the math to figure out what a 20-piece orchestra costs every week. I do not think that's enormously expensive when you consider that I have sat in production meetings in my life and somebody will say, we need a whole new set of costumes created by the end of the week. And I know that they'll spend, you know, 300 grand for that, or a new set piece, or we're gonna, you know, but then if I go to a producer and say, I need to re-orchestrate something in previews, they'll say, well, we already orchestrated. Why do we need to redo that? Why do we need to spend that money? Or why do we need a, what's called a continuity call before a preview, where you get an hour long rehearsal with the orchestra. Why do we need that call? You know, like, why don't they just read it on the stands? And you're like, because it's never going to go well if you put something into the show without rehearsing it. So it's always been slightly baffling to me that producers become very cheap when it comes to musicians. My hope is that the pendulum will swing back and we'll end up in a world where there are larger orchestras. I mean, I think I'm living in this slight dream world. But I think the good news as I started all of this is that you are going to see a lot more orchestras coming to this kind of repertoire, because they're going to have to. I mean, there's only so many movies that they can do with film, which I also think is a very bizarre notion. I don't know how many of you know about that kind of stuff, where it's like, go see your orchestra play Star Wars, or go see your orchestra play Home Alone. And that to me is actually not really music making, because you're kind of retrofitting something that is never put together that way. Like, they didn't record the score of Home Alone with the orchestra sitting there for one day. Like, they did each cue separately, and then it ends up coming together. And then they invite you to go see that evening, and the conductor is dealing with a horrible click track that keeps changing tempo every bar because it was set to a time code. So that's a really strange notion. So the real answer is, I wish I knew. I think we're all going to be figuring this out together. And, you know, I wish that there were more people who wrote really great music that we could put into new Broadway shows. I think that's part of the issue, is that we don't have people who think sonically for large orchestras. We have people who think for, you know, 8-piece bands. I remember having a really interesting conversation with Jonathan Tunick, who did a new orchestration for Carousel for me. And, you know, Jonathan Tunick began his career orchestrating for Sondheim with orchestras over, you know, 28, 30 people, and has now spent his career taking his original orchestrations of these shows and reducing them down to 12 pieces sometimes. And when you think about that, you're like, how strange for somebody to have to go back into their career, take a piece that they did all these years ago, and now completely redo it. I mean, that makes absolutely no sense to me. It's just like, that seems so backwards that we're like going down in numbers. It's very frustrating. So if any of you know young composers who write in a really wonderful old-fashioned style, who understand how to write something more than just a piano part, please encourage them to do that. So we'll all have work.
About a part of a show that has to be clicked because there's automation involved, so like actor safety. I'm thinking of the end of act one of Wicked or something that has to be the same every night because it's dance, and if it's not the same, it's dangerous. So how do you approach that and keep it musical?
In those cases, I actually believe it's 100% necessary because that's actually dealing with safety. When it comes to dance numbers in shows, I am often a fan of keeping my metronome right by me to keep a glance to make sure that I know what the outer limits of a piece are. Because here's what happens in a Broadway show, as it happens with anything, is you're doing something 8 times a week. It's repetitive stress syndrome. And very often what you'll find is, you know, you'll be 6 months into the run of a show and the choreographer, the director will come back and be like, oh, that's so slow. We need to speed that up. Because by human nature, or the opposite, they'll come in and they'll say, something's gotten so fast, it needs to slow down. Because what starts to happen is the muscle memory and the sort of synergy of everybody coming together to make the sound of something starts to mean that the block of sound, as it were, can then function in many different ways. So here's how like a Broadway show will end up working. It's like you have it, oftentimes like you have many days of just orchestra reads, and then you put together with the orchestra and you have your zitzpro, and then you have your sound check in the space, and then you go into several weeks of previews. And over the weeks of previews, anybody who is a regular, like a chair holder on a Broadway show, meaning that that's their book, they are not allowed to sub out. So for those 6 weeks up to opening, it's the same group of players every night. And then 2 weeks after opening, suddenly subs are allowed to start coming in. And so this beautifully curated and carefully crafted performance that you've built with dynamics and the whole band understanding how the flow of the show goes, that starts to go out the window, because then you have different people coming in and their sound is different and their attack is different. And oh, let's say tonight you have a different drummer, and that's, you know, and it makes the whole feel of the show feel very different to you. And, you know, then you end up with that show where both your drummer and your bass player are out, and you just feel like, as the conductor, you're like, oh my God, nothing feels the same to me. So in those moments, having things on click, like dance numbers, or I made a promise to Bette Midler when I was doing Dolly, I said, I'm putting the opening number on a metronome, and I will, you know, not slavishly, but I had that going for me because it was my belief that I felt for her sake, we needed the energy of the show to come out of the gate at the same tempo every night. So at least we were able to always start at a fighting chance. And in Dolly, there was a dance number in Act Two. There's the Waiter's Gallop, which is a very, very tricky number with a lot of moving, like they had carts rolling on and off stage. You had a lot of actors doing acrobatic tricks. You had actors jumping over. There was a passerelle, meaning that the orchestra pit sort of came out, or the stage came out behind me. So in a circumstance like that, I worked with the choreographer to figure out what was the, you know, what was the top level click for that. So in a situation like that, I was very insistent that we have a click set to that, because that was actor safety. And I will never interfere when it comes to a matter of safety. Where it becomes very challenging for the musicians is they're not on the click, but I'm watching it. So there were definitely passages in that where, because the playing became easier, there was a tendency to want to speed up. So my job in that circumstance was to always basically sort of almost, you know, like an opera prompter. It was like right before it would come up, I would always, you know, put up a hand, which meant like, here comes that spot that we always tend to rush, you know. And to me, I always felt like it required me to be even more vigilant about what the dynamics were in sections like those, to make sure that the musicianship then didn't go on autopilot in any way, that suddenly it's like, oh, well, this section, you know, the click is whatever it was, and so we don't need to, you know, we can just sort of phone this in. You know, I have certain issues with shows like Evan Hansen. I think there are songs in there that make no sense to me why they're on click, because when you get to it, nothing's happening on stage. So I think that is a level of control that makes zero sense to me and is actually stripping musicianship from it, because that's implying a forced set, because oftentimes there's a director that'll be like, no, it's too slow. Like a ballad's too slow. It needs to move fast. So I want it here. In the old days, the stage manager called all the cues. And look, I remember when I did Cinderella, I did the show for a year. I left for 6 months and then I came back. And I remember I conducted the show, my first performance back. And I had been doing another show at the time. And so I came back and I was just like in such a, I had like so much energy. And the stage manager came to me and he was like, okay. He was like, you are on crack. He was like, everything is so fast. He was like, you have to remember, because oftentimes cues are written based on where the show was on that day in tech. So the reason that Phantom of the Opera still plays the same way as it does is because in 1987, it was set a certain way. You don't have the chance to go back in 2020 and be like, let's rewrite that cue. You know, so you're oftentimes locked into, you know, what the timing of that beat was at that moment. And that's where, as humans, it can, you're almost fighting with your inner metronome to be like, gosh, it's gotten to a place where it feels slow to conduct it at that spot. But it has to be conducted there because that's what it is. And, you know, if it definitely comes to safety, safety first. Why don't I talk a little bit about subbing on Broadway, if that would help anybody?
That's great. That'd be super.
Subbing is a very interesting world, very complicated world, because it's the bane of every conductor's existence and the blessing of every player. And somebody once said two really great things to me about subbing, which was, one was like, if you have a solo in a particular section, memorize it and stare at the conductor. Because conductors often you know, part of the process of subbing is that you sit in the pit and you watch how the show goes. You oftentimes will get a recording as well as a video of the conductor conducting it to follow along with the score as you learn it. Where it becomes more challenging in certain days of our lives are that there are situations where you can't actually be in the pit with the conductor because either space is so tight or, you know, the band's on stage and you're not gonna actually get to be there until you do it that night. So there are always gonna be circumstances that you will never actually know what it feels like until you're in the heat of the moment. Then there's also the notion that certain shows have several conductors and you may be watching the conductor cam of conductor A, but when you can play the show, it's conductor B and conductor B does something slightly different. A lot of times players will indicate in the score, if so-and-so is conducting, they subdivide this. If so-and-so is conducting, they do this and this. And players will often be very helpful. Your goal, so number one was if you have a solo, memorize it and stare at the conductor, because then the conductor feels like you're paying attention. Number two, your goal is to be better than the actual player. I'll say that again. Your goal is to be better than the actual player. Because if I'm the conductor and I'm walking into a pit and I have, you know, a pit of 23 people and I have 10 subs that night, I don't want to be taken out of the moment because I still have to conduct the same show that I have to conduct. And I do not want to be distracted. So I want to know that if I look down and I expect that it's, you know, Joe on the clarinet, and I look down and I'm so surprised that it's, you know, Sharon, and she sounds so great, and I didn't even realize it was Sharon, that's the best compliment that you could ever give to a sub, is that you weren't even aware that it was a sub. And that's not to say to imitate sound. I have to be clear about that. I do still think, look, if you're a string player, obviously there's an aesthetic going on in the string section and you need to match that. If you're a wind player, you need to match the dynamics that need to be there. But, and same for brass or, you know, percussion. And look, obviously every pianist plays a piano differently. Every drummer plays that kit differently, bass, etc. You still need to feel like an individual, but you need to understand the sound that you're walking into and you need to try to fit in as best as possible without losing your own identity. Subbing is a really difficult thing and there are some people who are really good at it and there are some people who are absolutely terrible at it. The other thing that I encourage you to do is get to know players, but do not be aggressive about it. There is a line between being aggressive and being appreciative and accepted. You know, if you are a young conductor, you know, I have people when I'm doing shows that write to me, I will write back to all of them and say, great, come sit in the pit. Let's go out for coffee after. And I can always tell the difference between people who are legitimately like just wanting to learn and those who are going to try to push me down a flight of stairs. You do not want to be the latter. You want to be somebody who wants to learn and says, you know, how do I break in? You know, a lot of times kids that go to NYU who are musicians end up having professors that are players on Broadway. Oftentimes that ends up being a great feeder for them because, you know, they can get somewhere down on a sub list. So the way sub lists work is very complicated because let's say they announce, you know, Diana the musical is coming to Broadway, God bless us all. And there's, you know, 13 players are hired. The minute that show is announced, I guarantee you the band has already been hired and a person's sub list is already full. So your job is to find out who has the book. You write to them and say, hey, I'd love to come watch. I understand that you're probably full up. If an opportunity were to ever arise, I would love to be considered. But then what you should do is get to know who those subs are and find out who their subs are. Get to know those people and sort of work yourself down a little bit instead of pinning all your hopes that the regular is going to call you, because it's just not going to happen, because essentially a conductor really doesn't want more than 4 to 5 people playing a book anyway, because a regular player is only going to take off X amount of time. And you want people who are consistently staying on top of what that book is. The worst thing that could happen for you is you play the book at a show and you don't go back for 3 months. And then you go back in, you had spent all that time learning how to play the book. And then the next thing that happens is you come in and you haven't played it in 3 months and it's like starting over again. I've had subs come in and do that, and then I have to fire them because I'm like, well, it used to be good, but you haven't kept it up. And then the conversation is often with the regular that's like, look, if you want that person to still be on your roster, A, you need to encourage that they keep their skills up on the book, or you need to be giving them more opportunity. You know, where pianists have a bit of an easier in, or conductors, is, you know, you can start as a music assistant and then work yourself into becoming a rehearsal pianist on a show. And then if you've been playing rehearsal piano, then maybe you'll end up subbing on the keyboard book on the show and then sort of working your way in on that. You know, oftentimes the people that end up taking the show out on the road as conductors or associate conductors on the road are people who had worked on the show in New York in a lesser capacity as like a music assistant, who then goes out as an associate conductor on the road because they already have knowledge of the show, et cetera, et cetera. The subbing world continues to evolve. We are also in a place where, like, on this revival of Oklahoma that just happened this past year, a lot of the players in that show had never played a Broadway show before. They didn't know the ins and outs of how to be a regular chair holder, how many shows you were allowed to miss, how to find good subs that understand what a show requires. So there is a bit of a hierarchy there that if it's messed up too much can be a little bit dangerous when you know, there have been shows that have hired very green people who have never played shows before, and then it doesn't always go well because they don't understand. The playing the Broadway show mentality is a really strange thing. Now it's a very coveted thing to have a book on a show. If 50 years having a book on a show meant nothing because people would come in and sub and sight read that night and think nothing of it. We've upped the game of what's required of you, if that makes sense.
Hi. I was just wondering what advice you might give a college musician. And if we're not living in like New York City, how do we reach out to the right people to like start a career?
Good question. What do you play?
A violin.
Great. And where do you live?
I'm in Oregon right now.
I'm jealous. I love it there. I think, look, there's no right or wrong in any of this. I've met plenty of people over the years who are like, you know what? I want to live in Chicago and play everywhere there and never move to New York. There are people who are like, it's New York or bust, and I have to get to New York. So I can't decide that for you. I think what you do is you always want to figure out in your network who is there who can be an ally for you. If there's a teacher at school that knows people in New York and you say, who are some players on the scene that you know of or former students of yours that are on the scene that I could just connect with when I get to the city and offer and say, can I take you out to coffee? Can we go out to breakfast or go out to lunch and get to know people that way? You know, if you're at Clock, you're meeting how many different conductors or how many other instrumentalists that are potentially going to the city and doing that. You know, for instance, the summer that I was at Clock, the other associate conductor is the associate conductor at Aladdin now, and we're still good friends. And then when I was there that summer, I didn't work with him, but Dan Connectus, who went to Clock, ended up being a choreographer on a show that I worked on several years after that. And so, you know, the Clock network especially is a great network of people who, you know, are very entrenched in the scene and know a lot of people. But again, it's about delicately doing it and not pushing people down the stairs.
Thank you, Andy.
Of course, my pleasure. Bye.
Yay. Bye.
Second stage is part of our larger series, Digital Clock. Digital Clock is made possible by a generous gift from Phil and Liz Gross. If you'd like to learn more about our programming or how you can become a supporter, visit us at collegelightoperacompany.com. Tune in next week for another episode of Second Stage.